In the following two videos, we are going to talk about how we can determine real integrals by using Cauchy's residue theorem. The different kinds of integrals we are going to cover are the following four. And in this video, we will cover the first one, which is a proper integral. And in the next video, we will continue by covering the last three, which all are improper integrals. So let's get going. The characteristics of this first type of integral is that it needs to be made up of this function f, which is a rational function of sine and cosine, and that the limit of integration needs to go from 0 to 2 pi. And an example of an integral that satisfies these conditions are the following. And the trick to solve this integral is not to think about it as a real integral, but instead think about it as the parameterized form of some contour integral, which is made up of some complex function f taken around the contour that is the unit circle. And the reason why we use the unit circle here and not some other contour is that if we use the unit circle, then we know that the upper and lower bound for our parametrization will become 0 and 2 pi, which is exactly what we have as the upper and lower bound limits in our second integral. So in short, if we are able to determine what our complex function f looks like, then we can solve the integral to the left here by maybe using Cauchy's residue theorem, and by doing that also solve the real integral to the right. And since these two integrals are connected by the parametrization of a unit circle, we can try to use that one in reverse to determine the complex function f. So what we'd like to do now is to take everything inside of our integral here and instead express it as our parameterized variable c. So for example, we can start by looking at cosine here. And if you remember, the trigonometric identities for cosine and sine are the following. And since e raised to the power of I times alpha under this parametrization is going to be equal to c, we can rewrite this thing to the following. And also note here that e raised to the power of minus I alpha is instead going to become 1 divided by c. And by doing this, we have managed to rewrite our functions, cosine and sine, so that they only depend on the variable c. And if we now go back to our parametrization, I can rewrite the second statement here to see that d alpha is going to be equal to dc divided by I times c. And now we are ready to express everything in our second integral as an expression of c. So if we insert our new expression for d alpha and our new expression for cosine into this integral, we get the following. So by doing some simplifications here, first off by multiplying everything together, and then removing the factor 1 divided by 2i, and putting that one outside of the integral, we get the following. And now we can see that the integrand here has two poles, one at minus 2, and one at minus a half. And as you can notice, only one of them, the one at minus a half, is actually inside of our contour gamma. So when we now continue to apply the residue theorem to this integral, it is only the residue at this point that is going to be included, since the other one is outside of our contour. So the only thing we need to do now is to determine this residue. And we can do that by using this formula up here, since the point minus a half was a simple pole for the function. So if we use the formula, we get the following. And here we can do some simplification and cancel out these two factors. So we're going to end up with a limit as c approaches minus a half for 1 divided by c plus 2. And if we now take this limit, we get the following. And this can be simplified to the following. So we are going to end up with the answer 2 divided by 3. So now we can backtrack and go back to our first expression up here. And we can start by canceling out some common factors. And then we can also insert the value for the residue. And this thing will be equal to, let's see here, 2 pi divided by 3. So the real integral that we started with was equal to 2 pi divided by 3 all along. But the method that we used to determine this was that we took a step back and said that we are not going to solve the real integral. We are going to think about the real integral as a parametrization of some complex integral, right? And then we can solve that one instead by using Cauchy's residue theorem. But let's continue by doing another example. So here I would like us to try to determine the following real integral. But notice that the integral is written on the wrong form. This integral goes from 0 to pi, but we are going to need it to go from 0 to 2 pi if we would like to use the same method as before. But we can fix that by using a clever substitution. Because as you might know, cosine of alpha is equal to cosine of 2 pi minus alpha. So what we can do now is to create a new variable. So 2 pi minus alpha is going to become our new variable theta. And this also means that d theta is equal to minus d alpha. And if we substitute this into our integral, we get the following. So now instead we have an integral that goes from 2 pi to pi. But since we have a minus sign in front of the integral, we can just remove a minus sign and swap the start and end point for the integral. And I could actually stop here, but I want to make my main conclusion crystal clear, so I'm going to do one more thing. The thing I'm going to do is that the variable theta here is only a variable in one dimension that describes the angle. So I'm just going to call it something else. I'm going to call it alpha instead, because that one was the name for the variable that we started with. And if I do that, we get the following. And from this we can see that the integral that we started with, which I'm going to denote here as I, is going to be equal to the same integral, but taken from a different start and end point. The first integral goes from 0 to pi, meanwhile the second integral goes from pi to 2 pi. So if we would add these two integrals together, then we would end up with the integral that we wanted from the start, an integral that goes from 0 to 2 pi. And since these two integrals are equal to each other, and we denoted the value for our first integral as I, this new integral is simply going to be equal to 2i. And now we are ready to use the same method as before. So if we now continue by using the following parameterization and substitutions, and insert them into our integral, we get the following. And if we now continue by doing some simplifications, we get the following. And the denominator in this new expression will have the following two zeros. It will have one zero at 2 minus the square root of 3, and another one at 2 plus the square root of 3. And by using this knowledge, I can rewrite the expression in the integral to the following. And now we can also notice that it is only one of these two points that is inside of our contour gamma. So when we now continue to apply the residue theorem to this integral, we get the following. We can simplify this a bit by cancelling out the two i's. And then we can see here that the point for this residue is a simple pole, so we can once again use this formula up here. And if we use that one, we get the following. And now we can simplify this by cancelling out some common factors, which will give us the following. And if we now take the limit as c approaches 2 minus the square root of 3, we get the following. And in this new expression we have 2 minus 2 here, so we can remove these two for each other. So in the end we are going to end up with 1 divided by 2 times the square root of 3. And if we now go back and insert this result up here, we get the following. And if we simplify this, we will get that this thing will be equal to 2 pi divided by the square root of 3. And now we have to remember that this thing is equal to 2i, and we would like to know what I is, since that one was the integral that we started with. So now we simply have to divide this result by 2 to get our final answer. This second example we just did is probably the harder ones you're going to stumble upon in your course for these kinds of examples, because here you have to try to rewrite your first integral to get it on the right form. And that can be really tricky in some cases if you don't know your properties for cosine and sine. But after that you can just use the parameterization for the unit circle to get the complex integral, which you then can solve by using Cauchy's residue theorem. And that was everything for this time. Consider subscribing if you like what I do here. And thanks for watching.